So again, let's continue today from what we left last day. We ended up with a cube which wouldn't rotate no matter what. Let me turn this a little bit lower. And well, today we're gonna make that cube rotate. I've done some background research and I'm confident this will work today. At least I think so. So okay, let's go in. Let me check if it's working fine. I've done scaled resolution to 720p, so it should be better today, smoother. And let's see how this goes. So first off, I did some modifications which I don't actually like. You know, here we had the emit which we changed it for a normal callback, but that wasn't really a bottleneck. I've just double checked it later. So we are going to simply remove this. There's no need for this anymore, nor for the function. And we're going to set our callback, our emit back, which includes going to our game. No, I mean to our main, and setting this back. Okay. So far so good. Yeah, that's fine. So I've done some background research on my library. You know, I'm using ZFW to render Windows and to make it cross platform. And it seems that by default, our buffer, our double buffer, which is right now here on our draw method here, it seems like this is automatically using Vsync, which means it won't render more than our screen refresh rate. In my case, my screen goes to 60, so this means that it won't run any faster than 60. If you would actually want to make it faster, we need to specify we want it like this. So I'll do it on our game engine. Once again, this should be configurable. But in any case, let's simply do it like this. ZFW swap interval. That means how many times it will wait for our screen to update. So we will simply set this to 0, which will cause our FPS to increase drastically. Let's just see it. I mean, see here, each flash is an FPS, so I don't even have to say nothing, it's obvious. Okay, I've just seen there's no shell, and I wonder why. Let me check, why don't there? Let's go here, build, source, debug resources. Oh, we're not copying the right folder. I believe last day I did some modifications to this, so that our folder would be copied. And I may have screwed it. So source semicolon there. Yeah, that's not right. Our software already is telling it which source we want. So that's really not right. No. It's completely wrong. Let's check like this. Let's see if we have our cube back. It's updating from Git, it won't actually update nothing, but still no cube. Oh, of course, I mean, we have to reboot. I know. Let's reload it and build again. Sorry, I must be out of here. Check again. No, still it won't copy. Copy directory. Deep RAMming, that seems to be fine. However, it's not actually. Of course, it should be file name. Let's try again. go back to the game. This won't immediately work. No. Let's build again. Whoa. That wasn't expected. Let's try. Okay, copying files. It actually been copied. More or less. There's a folder. Empty. Do you have something here? Yeah, we have. That shouldn't be empty. Let's go about to our semic. That should be copy. I mean, it says copying files. They probably don't look at them resources, which is just fine. Yeah. And for each one in here, let's make another message. Oh no, we can't. Okay. I don't know if we can put a comment here. Let's try again. That's CMake language. I don't know if any of you have already seen it. But basically, a way of building universal binaries. I mean binaries, universal makefiles. So we don't actually have to be building a specific release for Visual Studio 12, Visual Studio 13, for Linux. It builds everything in a single file, so it's actually really useful. However, it seems it won't work. Thank you. I've just seen that message. That's a really nice thing to know. I've actually downscaled. The other day there were some smoothing problems, so I'm glad today is better. Okay, copying files. My comment seems like hasn't reached anyone. This comment hasn't been uploaded, which is weird. And copy this. Let's simply put copy this, which is what we are actually looping here. Let's see what's happening, what's going on. Filing. Reload. Copying files, resources, okay, that's fine. We would actually, I believe it could be better if instead of relative files, we would actually use absolute. Well, that doesn't really matter. So, copying files, copy theirs, that's fine. And I don't actually know why it isn't working. It seems like it should. But yesterday, let's see what we have yesterday. Let's run bash, git bash. Let's go to our. And let's see what changed. Oh, sorry. I don't know what I have done. So let's go back to. What did we change here? See, we changed that from here to here. So we actually had source is current directory, current CMake dir. Let's try like this again. CMake. Of course, if we are doing relative to this path, we should use this. So, source is this followed by file name. That was some weird change I did here. It was actually fine. I don't know. Maybe we did this. Yeah. It should now really do the copy. Let's simply check this. Okay, here though. That's fine. So our cube is back. That's nice. Still no rotation, as you see. And the problem actually comes from our mouse moving. See, if my mouse is mostly not moving, it does rotate. And doing some background search, I did find here in our cursor post handler, we're actually telling the scheduler to run on main thread this little function, this emit. What's really happening is that every single time I move my mouse, this is being queued into our schedule, and I believe there's too much thing queued here. If we just remove this, see, it will actually go better. I believe this. So yeah, see. Now it's really rotating. A little bit slow, but that's because our code is not as it should be here. It's a little bit too divided, but well, now it should be faster. So yeah, our problem is this. We are pushing far too many emits toward main thread. Still there are some problems. I mean, we defined on last video our game main loop, which is on the scheduler object. We defined this. That may be erased. So we defined this, and at this very moment, this is running outside of our game logic, and it's not being called 6 times per second as it should. So we kindly have to separate methods here, which doesn't really... Well, it shouldn't work like this. We should only update our mouse position every single time our scheduler is being called, just for consistency. I mean, there's no sense in telling it to do 6 clicks per second and then actually updating every time we detect a mouse rotation, movement. So yeah, we should actually fix that. And there's no easy fix for it. What I'm going to do is I'll keep this emit here this way, but I'm actually going to check every time if we have already executed this using this tick. So we need one variable. Let's do it atomic boolean. Atomic means no reading and writing at the same time. It's basically for consistency. So we're going to call it std atomic. Mouse updated, which will by default be false. Of course, I mean, an update first, and we're only going to push this onto our main thread in case, well, I mean, everything could be commented out, so we do less necessary code, of course not this. We need a pointer to our window, so if our window mouse updated haven't already happened, hasn't already happened now, we'll do this, and we have to preset this whenever this is being called, this function. It's a lambda function, new on C++11, so it basically means a function inlined. It could be the same as declaring here a function, giving the name, and then passing here the function name instead of this lambda function, so it's way faster doing it like this. Now we have our window, that's fine, and we must set our mouse updated to false. However, hello introspective, that's some plugin I made in a language called Autoit using the Twitch API. I'll release this code on GitHub maybe tomorrow when it's a little bit clear. So thank you for subscribing or following. Okay, back to our code. Our signed code, fine, this is updating. I don't know if this will work, as mouse update is private within our class. It should still work in the sense that this is a window method, so we're in the same context, it shouldn't complain. But let's just check it. Fine, it compiled fine, so perfect. Oh, and we have to tell it. We thankfully updated. So let's try it. Still, my mouse is moving, this isn't working, and that makes no sense. So let's check what's happening, what's really happening here. I will remove this flash. It's actually printing way too many times per second. So let's remove it and let's check what is this qubit. Print qubit, just so we know. And let's print also whenever it's executed. So let's print it. I'm doing it like this, I'm not using breakpoints for simplicity. I mean, this would actually be called way too many times for it to be breakpointed. So, see, it's actually called one time per logic loop. As we see, point executed qubit, point executed qubit, so that's fine. And whenever I'm moving, I'm pressing that's working too. So, another real question is, why isn't it rotating the cube? If I'm actually doing it as it should. Let's see what happens. I'm emitting on the main thread, so let's get over here. We'll actually do all the game updating logic. We'll come here and we'll do all time one executions, which we'll call our window method. Move this here. So that being called means it should work. I mean, there's no reason for it not to work doing it like this. The update happened just before. Of course we won't do the logical update until the next tip, so we're actually doing a mouse movement here and on the next loop the rotation. That shouldn't be that much of a problem. So why isn't it actually updating? Let's see what our game mouse move function does. So basically get mouse pause and update cube rotation, which is done here. And simply set the rotation matrix to be GLM rotate. That should be fine. It's actually not using the orangle, but I believe that some modification we did last day. And that route is neither. Okay, so basically that wasn't a problem yet, so we have to find it. Let's compile. Build, sorry. So, let's try again. Still, mouse movement and rotation not working. Let's check why. Back to our window. Let's go back to our sync method. Simply queuing. That should be no problem. And then we're getting 5 elements from our queue and executing them one by one. It should be completely fine. Entering line calling gate. Just liking me calling it like this. Window. Well, where is our window here? Let's see what happens if I don't really use it. And call again. Using this very same if, but calling like this. I mean, we're already in the main thread. There's no need for citing it. Now that I think of it. Oh, here, look at it. Oh, that's nice. We've got our cube rotating again. See, there's one little problem now, however. It is rotating at our game logic speed, not at our FPS speed. So now we are driving 60, or I don't know, we are actually updating 60 times per second, as we defined on our main. Let's see what would happen if I actually, if I, you know, updated 2 times per second. That's 60 divided by 30, so that's it. We should actually see it a little bit slide, a bit slow. I think it won't look good. So here, you see. So that's a problem. And we would actually like to see and a smooth movement. That's really, really, really awful. So, we're going to take some advantage of what we defined earlier on our scheduler loop, which is the interpolate factor. So, it's already being sent to our update temp function, which is indeed calling our draw function here, which already has the interpolate value. However, our cube is taking no advantage of this, so let's do it. I close everything, that so many files are distracting. So let's open cube game and cube cpp. Why? Because draw is an overloaded function, overridden. So we're actually going to define it everywhere to use interpolation. What am I missing? Oh, I'm missing object. I thought I opened it. Okay, that's fine. So, back to our code, we now have the interpolate. And what we actually have to do is, whenever we call draw, if this interpolate value is greater than 0, if it's 0, there's nothing to do, we actually have to still apply the rotation given by this matrix, which is as simple as calling our update point function and our update function so that the points get saved to our GPU. So let's try it. That should make look it actually good, of course. We have must send our interpolate argument here. Let's try it. See, smoothness is back here again, and we're still doing 2 ticks per second. So, it's actually working, and real good. That's nice. So, back to our main, let's just set our FPS back to 60. That's what we want. Fine. Okay, so today I want to do some more things. Yesterday I did some really ugly code. I mean, let's go to our DAO. This draw proper function here is no longer useful. Well, I said yesterday, I meant the last day I did some stream. So, yeah, I did some really awful hacks here and there. Scheduler method. Oh, now that I remember. Or window resize. It's also happening. It's also calling this sync. And that may be out of our game logic, but well. We might consider resize in a special case. I mean, yeah, we might consider it in a special case. It's not actually affecting our game logic. It won't make any physics change. So yeah, let's consider it in a special case and leave it like this. It makes sense to be like this. So back to what I was saying. We need some really bad looking methods. For example, our scheduler.h file actually has a function called sync, which accepts a function and in the argument. That's completely fine. However, our cube needs to update points and update here. And what we were doing, again, not nice, was using a function called update grabber defined on the CPP. That's completely ugly. So let's try to make this somehow better looking. What we are actually going to do is we'll define another sync method, exactly the same template, type name t. Remember, t is actually our base time, and we will accept one more parameter, or rather parameter type, a class called I don't know c, and we'll copy this. But we'll accept here a pointer to our class, and we'll call it, I don't know, call. And instead this function will be a lambda function accepting one parameter arc, which will call color function. I know that's a little bit weird, but basically we're actually wrapping this function, which will be a class function, in a lambda function. So for this to work, we must capture, it's calling capture, and simply means getting these parameters here into the lambda function. We must capture them for them to be available inside. So that will actually do, it will save a lambda function inside the structure, which will get queued into our query, and will later be called without any need for us to do this declaration here. Let's try it. So we will actually want to do sync, and we'll send the cube, and we need one parameter, which I believe was our cube pointer. Well, there's not even any need for us to do, you know, we want to do the update, so there's no parameter. Let's try this. Back to our code scanner here. We don't need any parameter at all, so let's keep it simple. But that's actually old. New style should be null petier. There was missing. No. And let's try now again. We would actually want to call our cube update using our cube as pointer. That's fine. That won't be necessary. So that's fine. And that's actually not really true, because our cube update, let's go to our cube update. See here, it's only sending our points. That's not actually true, I mean. Of course, I removed this call. This call shouldn't have been removed. Now it makes sense. Yeah, now it makes completely sense. That shouldn't have been removed. So, yeah. And it should be compiling. Well, let's try it. See here. Unable to match function definition to existing class. What's the error? Line here, that shouldn't be setting one parameter, or should it? No, this should be setting one parameter, but this shouldn't be setting any parameter. And again, let's see. This I'm liking this definition here. Unable to match function definition to existing declaration. So what this actually means is it isn't liking whatever I'm doing here, although it should be liking it. Oh, of course, I've defined the function body, but I've never went into the class and defined the function. So and again, template class T, void scheduler, sync, okay. Now it should be, okay, it's complaining about a completely different thing, and that's me being, okay, now, see, a lot of errors. T is not T, of course, we've defined T here as time base, and, well, there's not actually a need for this, so, and me being a little bit stupid. So back here, let me see what's complaining about. Int should be preset, of course. Again, it's not my day today, so now that's better, less efforts. Still it isn't liking it. Let's see why. So it's complaining, we have actually two definitions, but none of them matches our current definition. And that shouldn't be happening. I believe it's due to this being here. That shouldn't be possible, but here, let's check it. That's it, okay. So I'm actually doing it like this. You would normally, whoa, that's our call is not correct. And well, it's this not our compiling. Then again, that's actually done here like this and not like this as it would normally be done, because this first template is actually modifying our class. See here, it's a class, it's a template modifying our class, and this one is modifying our function or method. So that's why we are doing it one next to the other instead of simply separating them by a comma. Okay, fine. And now it's telling me warning, that's no problem. And here, function number of object. So, color func. Of course, that makes no sense. That's fine. Well, this really doesn't make any sense. So, what we actually want is a C class function accepting no parameters, and that should be it. Of course, unless I've done something really weird and not actually defined any function. Let me check again. No, okay, I'm doing it wrong, of course. But I can't see why. What we actually want is a function of our C class. I believe it was done like this, but I may be completely wrong. For that should be a void C func. Okay, now that's better. And it calls me, of course, I've modified it here. So that's actually a function being return type void and accepting no parameters. That void here might be removed with no problem. Well, and of course, then again, I have to change it here. So now it should compile with no problems. That's it. Well, that's still not working here. Not here. Whoa. Where's the actual error? Here. So it's not liking this. And it tells us cannot convert argument 1 from that to that. Well, this function is a void function, so that actually makes sense. It's getting called on the other version. Let's explicitly tell us we wanted to call it on the cube class. Okay, and it says it doesn't match the arguments. Why doesn't it match the arguments? We actually want a function, and that's it. Of course, cube is of type object, and we're expecting type cube. Now, that's it. We can do this cast safely. Well, that's not it, there's an error, but we somehow advanced. And cube is declared type object. That's giving us more problems than anything, but as we know that it's being created with cube as type, we can do this cast completely safe. So then again, func is not a method of cube, and that's of course because this cal is not correct. We actually want to do this. You may think this is weird, but this is actually the way all callbacks were done, and that's the C callback function that means get the color or actual object and use this function with given here with no object, convert it to the one of this current object and call it. So that's it. Yeah, okay, compiling. Let's see, it still works. Fantastic. Yeah, that's completely working. So now this looks better. I mean, we don't need to declare that function here, and that's fine. This update points function, I don't like how it sounds. I mean, what we're actually doing is one update, one CPU based update, and one GPU based update. This one can be done on our CPU. This CPU. This one can be done on any thread, and this one must be done on the main thread as this GL calls imply it. So let's go to our object and let's keep names clear. I mean, void update, let's call it update GPU and update, so that we actually make any difference between these two. And our cube will use these very same methods, update and update GPU. Update points no longer exist, it's update, and this one it's update GPU. And here, update GPU. Remember to know, it's being called from the main thread, so there's no problem in calling update GPU from here. That's why we do it like this. Back to our game logic, we're calling update, that's fine. And this update point makes no sense again, so cube, update, and on main thread we're going to do the update GPU. Fine, compile again. Fine, it compiles. And now, just for the sake of being completely strictly lazy, if that's what I call it, let's make an inline method. Let's make line void. Let me change this again. I know it's not really the best to go changing here and there every single time, but you'll understand it when I do it. So yeah, our game also calls update. So we're gonna do an update method. As we've just done, this method no longer makes sense. And we're gonna do this one over here, this one will be on the object. Inline void update, which will simplify our job and will call for us update and schedule our update GPU method. Like this. And this get, of course, it must be included. Include scheduler HTTP. Now, so you will only have to call update. Everything else will be taken care of here. Here. As it is in line, there will be no performance issues by doing this, as all this code will be copied here as if we did no call. So that's fine. Cube isn't a class, of course. We will call object update GPU this, and as update GPU is a virtual overwrited function, it will call the actual re-implemented function. And see here, there's a warning. We are not returning from every case. Of course not. I mean, update the save void function. Why is it telling us that? Oh, yeah. Recursive follow control path function. Oh, see, there was a big mistake here. It's important to read all warnings, even though they are warnings, as they may give some important clues. I mean, what I was doing here now was literally calling, and doing nothing. So, yeah, read warnings. They may provide important clues. Okay. Back to more cube, still rotates. Quite faster, but rotates. And even if I accidentally removed the point here. Yes, I don't. Let's keep it just to know it's running. I mean, there's no real use for this, but simply to know it. Okay, fine. So, we already did some work here. Yeah, that's actually updating. Our method look way cleaner now. Okay, next, I believe we've done already all the major work for game engine as for it to work. I believe it's time for me to say what this game will be about and what we will do it, will be doing. So we'll kind of do not a Minecraft, but we'll use the simple logic of having cubes to make a game. I mean, I'll use cubes since it is simple. Simple to draw, simple to map textures, and we'll be doing some kind of mystery horror game. I don't know exactly how to define it. That will basically consist of, as the name says, not looking, well, the name says, this name says, not looking at our enemies. So, the first we need to do is clean up this cube code and see that everything is working fine. So right now we are defining a cube of size 1, from minus 0.5 to 0.5, so it will have size 1. And we will actually, let me drink a moment. I'm a healthy person, you see, issues. So, okay, we actually want to draw a virtual world. We'll make our scene, I don't know, consist of, let's say, maybe 20 cubes per 20 cubes. I don't know, let's define this on the game, as it's a game method. This isn't used, so let's delete it. Let's define an GLM back 3 scene dimensions. I usually, indeed, I always do use an underscore for private variables, for private attributes, and that's just for clarity and for style. So let's use it here. Oh, it was actually being used. I thought it wasn't, so. Let's bring it back. Okay. And let's add the underscore. I mean, there's no real reason for it. It's just for me to know this variable is pivot and to keep it in mind. So let's put it back to place. And here. Okay, that's fine. So we're defining, as I said, our scene dimensions by a size of course here too, of 20 per 20. Well, it could actually be a cube, so that's simply this 20 20 20. So we'll fit 20 cubes square on our actual scene. That's fine. And to be able to do this, we'll have to resize our cube to this size. That might be done two ways. One of them is via GPU, and we need one simple time, and the other is on our GLSL file. Both ways work, and they have no real difference, as it's a one-time operation, so we'll just do it on the CPU and keep it like this. I mean, there's no real reason to do it on the GPU. If it was done every single iteration, that could be a massive reason for doing it on the GLSL, but it's not the case. So let's simply go to our cube as initialized, and we're going to send it our parameters so that we can scale it in line and not overcomplicate everything. Cube initialize will accept the GLM vex3 scene dimensions. Of course, override, because it is defined an object. So back to our object that interacts here. And here again. And now we'll simply apply on every point one transformation, which is, well, I don't like copying code over and over and over, so let's just do this as a temporary solution, but it will be changed. So what we're actually going to do is create a CLM matrix called scale, which will be a CLM scale. I've actually haven't looked at how CLM scale works, so let's do a quick search on YouTube. Oops, it opened here. CLM scale. I believe, I'm almost sure, it will require, this will be the matrix type, and this will be our actual scale parameters, but let's just check for, to be sure, here. Scale. Transform something, just gonna forget it from. Okay, now let's look for. There was actually some examples. Yeah, here. So, yeah. We're calling git. Well, I don't really know how it's being called. Let's go here, scan. Transform some matrix with GLL. Oh, so it actually accepts one matrix. So we will actually simply send it the identity matrix. Identity matrix in GLM might simply be done like this. You could specify every single position, but there's no need for it. Calling the default construction will actually create an identity matrix. And we'll tell it to scale it. If our cube is one size, I mean, we'll just tell it here, set here from plus to minus, there's one unit. We're going to need to scale it 20 units smaller, or in this case, scene dimensions smaller, so I'd like to do this. 1 divided by this. Unless GLM doesn't implement this, nope, it does not. So we'll simply do a GLM vex free consisting of 1 divided by x, 1 divided, yeah, by 1. And y divided by 2. And that's fine. So now we'll scale every single point. Let's see. Fine, that's perfect. See? That scaled. It's actually a little, so fine. And we now might try to render a simple floor. Let's see, we'll try to create, I don't know how many blocks. Let's just do an std vector cube, and let's call it floor, and let's create, we've said the scene is actually 20x20, so we might start from 20 is 0, that equals, oops, sorry, and for the other axis, and we'll be starting pushing back cubes here. So I'm using some ID for each cube, as you see here in the first parameter. So we may simply call it wiper20 plus J, and that would give us a unique identifier for each of them. You know, this is row, this is columns, so if we multiply each row per 20 and sum up the column, we won't end up with any number repeated here. Okay, once we have that, we must initialize the cube, and we must move it. So let's do a simple method for moving objects around. Okay, let's move. We have here a declaration of points and one of colors. which is only for cubes. That'd be fine as long as we only use cubes, but some point we will want to draw something else, and we might consider moving everything from points to colors to rotation, etc. to our actual object class. So let's do it now, and let's keep everything clear. We have 36 points, so let's keep this. We should do it here. Let's just write it down so that we don't forget. Okay, so this must be moved. That's fine. Rotation matrix might be moved too. I mean, yeah, we might do it. Let's move this here. Now you'll see why. And instead of making it a fixed size array, we'll just make a pointer. And we'll initialize that pointer to null. That's a must of C++ and C. Let's see our, sorry here, let's see our object. Let's move here, okay. And we initialize points to null PTR and colors to null PTR. So yeah, that's a comment here. It's a non-static class. What's he complaining about? I don't know, what's he complaining about? What is the static? I don't know, was it complaining about this? It makes no sense at all for it to complain about this. Maybe I'm not including. No, the elements include. So I don't actually know why it's complaining. I do it just like this. Well, still. Points isn't defined. What have I just done? Of course. See that underscore, I always put it, and when I forget about it, that's what happens. That nothing makes sense. Then again, our rotation might be moved too, and I'll do it in line, as to avoid spending too much time on operations. LFS inline, it's a macro I declared, and shit, it just means inline. There's no real difference in it. So let's do it like this. For consistency, again, let's move this down here. All inline functions must be declared in the header, be it inside the class or outside, but in the header. Never, no matter what, on the CPP file, it won't even compile. So yeah, do it on the header. Glm rotate does not exist because I'm no longer using the include, which should be moved here. Fine. And what else? Notice move here, okay, fine. For some points, you see everything of this must be underscored, so yeah. But must be completely changed. Okay, let's do it. And everything else is fine. So let's do a quick find and replace. I don't actually want to be changing them one by one, so and the same goes for colors. I hope I haven't changed anything. And this is private, and it shouldn't. It should actually be at least protected. I don't actually want to make everything public. It's a bad thing to do. You should keep everything it's calling encapsulated, means everything to its class. And if you ever have to use it, make a getter or setter method, as I've done here with ID. So better not to expose things to other classes. And don't hear something really well. Where the explorers, what happened here? What happened on? Oh, okay. The array wasn't actually called the array was called vertex colors and colors. And I've changed it. Seems like this. No. I don't really know, but oh, of course. Something here. Colors index equals vertex colors. Okay. No. That was my fault, I just lost for a moment. So no, it's working. Fine, that's fine. Num vertices, we might declare this here const int num vertices equals 36. And we'll move this here. And now we must allocate some size for our points. Let's do it C style. C++ style, I mean, not C style. And for colors. Colors will actually get graded really soon once we get textures, but let's just keep it now so that we can see something. And num vertices, it's 36, and this is 36. You know, I don't know what I'm doing this. Let's simply move this declaration here to a class attribute. And we'll keep everything fine and happy and compiling. So yeah, that's it. And we were doing the move method. Rather move, let's call it translate, which is somehow more accurate. Translate glm vect3 trans. I'm actually using vect3 here and not vect4, as we don't actually want to use any translate on the W coordinate. That's a miscellaneous one and we don't actually want to change it. Whatever it is, it will stay as this. We normally or usually or always use one here, and it will only be changed on the shader itself whenever we do some projections, which I believe might be done on the next day. So yeah, let's keep it like this. Let's go to our object HTTP, and we're going to do some translations. Void object translate. And we're going to, well, we actually have to keep everything, all the transformations on a single side. So let's look here, transformations. Let's keep them, all of them in a single array instead of having one for each one. Yeah, and do we actually need to set this to the entity whenever we've done it? Yeah, we have to. So that's fine. And whenever we call this method, we actually want to apply to all transformations. So yeah, we'll actually do it like this. So all transformation are cumulative, and we will translate using the identity matrix again, as we've done with rotations and with scales. So and translate. So that's fine. And we were doing our floor, which will consist of every cube. Let's do this. Cube. Which will consist of every cube translated to the set E defines row. So let's say we'll move along axes X and Z, and we'll reserve Y for I don't know how to say it, for hey, I forgot about it. So let's check this is here declared the same. Yeah, here we're not using this, well, we're not doing it like this here. will check it back later, so translate. First cube must be on 0, 0 being left corner here, so that's totally 0, 0. Or default screen on GSL, on OpenGL is defined from -1 to 1, 1. So we actually move to left top, so that's move template. Vex 3, GLM Vex 3, sorry. -1, we set Y, we'll keep it for height, so let's leave it like this. It's fine. Is it expecting something else? What's it expecting? One vector, so. Oh, that's it. And it doesn't like this because we've declared a cube object and there's no need for it to be here. We'll just declare it here and cube. Well, fine. That cube makes no longer any sense, so what we'll do instead is iterate the whole cube list. Let's do this in C++11. So for auto pointer cube equal that's like an in Python in floor. We'll simply do that cube. I hope this will work and won't mess up with the iterator. I've never actually done this, so I hope it will work. And then again, on every draw, we'll need to update every single cube, and we'll need to draw every single cube. One way of doing this is by simply using an iteration over all cubes, as we've done sooner, and that would actually work. And simply moving this here. Flores to this. I've again not used an underscore here, and that bothers me. You know, consistency in style with oneself is important. So that would actually work, but it doesn't take any profit out of our threading scheme, of our scheduler, of our pool thread. So why, instead of doing this, don't we move every single update of every single block into one thread? Yeah. So what we actually want to do is, instead of doing this, we'll use our pool, our thread pool, we'll get it, and we'll enqueue one function. I don't remember how pool function was declared, so let's check it. Here. See, pool function is a function expecting an int return type and a void parameter, which is not what our update function is doing. So once again, we change it. I know it's kind of ridiculous to be changing every single time, but it's for a good reason. So back here. Oh, of course, it's only need to change here. So again, consistency. Let's move this just a little bit below. Let's move this here. And I have the update. And this is object update. So fine. And back to our game. What we will do is in Kiwi every single update. So once again, this will take an object and will take a method. So our day update or day Kiwi method won't work. Let's see it here. Our in Kiwi method still expects a function and argument, and we must do something alike with it. Here on the scheduler that we defined this kind of C style comma combined with C++11, so let's do just the same here. We have one Kiwi method which returns a future, and we'll do the same in theory, but will accept the INT. That must be a template. Template class C, feature C, function, and of parameter void, and accepting void arm. Now, this is not in line, as you see. It might be a good idea to do it in line, as that will be called way too many times, and it's even a template function, so let's just do it in line. It makes more sense than being on the CPP. Let's do it here. Shooting kiwi. That's the old function. It's actually the old function. That's fine. Shoot pulling kiwi. And it's complaining because. And once again, let's go to our setpool cpp file. Let's get this code. Let's put it in here. And let's see what it actually does. See? We might. Or copy this all over again. Or we might simply do an enqueue call to the original function, to this one, creating, as we did earlier, a lambda function. Argument void parameter, which you won't actually use, but you know, requirements, so. And we'll do a C call style again. Func with argument. Well, we can actually do this funnier, like this. So, that's somehow well. This argument will be passed here, that might not be necessary, and we simply return this again. Okay, now as we did this function in line, we should do this function in line, or we won't take any profit of making the former one in line, so let's move it in line too. This one must move to be in line here. Feature set pull and queue, that's fine, we don't have to do any modification at all. Let's simply build for a moment. See, pull task wrapper has no constructors, I mean, and that's because task wrapper has been included here. Let's include it here. Okay, set pull is building fine. And let's see if our game builds it. No, it won't, as we haven't already updated this, so let's do it. What we actually want to do is a cube update call using our cube space. No, our cube no, or floor y space. And the same goes for this. But here, that makes no sense to give everything on the set pool, as all those must happen on the main thread. So here we'll keep it like this. And that's okay. Of course, interpolate back to our workbook. Cube and declare course. Let's forward declare cube instead of object. We no longer use object cube. Cube is undeclared. Once again. Well, now rotations has no sense at all. I mean, there's no one cube to rotate. We are already building our floor, so let's simply keep it like this. That's only the problem with our translations, and that's that I haven't taken into account our row and our position, so well, we'll do it now. Yeah, we should do it now. Well, let's see it built. There were some errors, I mean. 27 Days Match, update top 6 function call with encargument list. Let's see here. That should be like this. Okay. And we've missed something here, it says. Missing before. It says we're missing something here, but we are not missing something. So we are queuing this function with one argument. this must return int has to be function. Sorry. So we'll simply return this. Now it built. This kind of return type is known in C++11 as a way to indicate return just the preferred. Deferred, I mean, as it, I would do here this, it would simply be the same. It's redundant as I'm doing this here and here, so I should actually do this. It's not yet supported for in all Visual Studio builds. I don't know if 2013 already includes it, but well, let's keep it like this. And there was an error. Okay, again, warning, since mismatch. So that should be a size D. Should be what else? This here too. And they're still complaining we are doing something weird here. And I don't know why. So let's see. And queuing. I don't know if it's getting confused on what this was. Let's go to our scheduler class. Let's see what here. We did like here. We are doing exactly the same, so it should be perfectly fine. And it's not liking, it's telling us we're using an object class for this enqueue, and that shouldn't be true. We're actually not doing any. See here, object cannot instead abstract class. That's because we are not enqueuing an object, but we're enqueuing a cube. Here. Let's explicitly delete one cubes. See, now it isn't liking it, so that's already some kind of problem. Let's see what is it wrong. INT and void. Expecting INT void, and we are sending it INT void, which is fine. That's weird. Did we have here some remaining code? No. So we're queuing. That may be because update is a method of object, as we are not overriding it. And it may not be liking us telling it to be a cube, let's say it to be an object. And let's then cast this to object. Still no luck. Of course, no luck. Okay, yeah, okay. Now I get why it isn't working. It's not a question of implicit or explicit or whatever, it's a question of me not telling it that we actually want our class here. So yeah, that's actually my mistake. And that should be color. Okay, now they should work. Of course, no, it won't work. We haven't specified the third argument. So let's do it. We actually want nothing being passed here, so Thank you, it doesn't take 3 hours. I thought it did. 1, 2, 3. So yeah, it takes 3 arguments. Isn't it working? Close. 1 second. Let's tell it it's an object. Let's tell him this cube. Actually, it's an object. And now it's happy. And we must tell, see that error I told you before, we are not implicitly capturing because null capture method has been specified. So that basically means inside lambda function, this color variable is already declared, and we must tell it to explicitly grab it from outside. So that's how you do it. We won't see 20 codes, because they will all be moved to the same position as our translate is moving them all to the same position, but all the idea is there, and that they might return something, so let's return one just for the sake of returning something. So we are not seeing anything at all. Oh, of course we are not. I mean, I've moved everything to a positive, no, negative set here, so we should be seeing something. Unless I'm moving it too far away. So this is could be defined. It's completely centered at the origin. Let's not move it, let's try not moving it. I'm simply doing this. Nope. Let's not move it at all. And let's see if it's working. Just before. Okay, no, it's not working, so that's our order. Is it not being dropped or it's not being updated? So let's try to update it like this. Update nothing at all. Let's try this. See nothing here. It's not working. And why isn't working? It's not working. It was with one cube, as you remember, it actually worked. So let's simply add one cube here. And let's see what happens. Of course, that doesn't make any sense. No cube at all, and that means we are not drawing more cubes as we should. And that may be because we're forgetting to call something we used to call. Initialize, draw, update is being called, that's fine. Of course, the constructor is being called. We are storing memory for it, that's fine. That was already done indeed, so that's not the error. Oh, no, yeah, it's pushed to the vector, so that's fine too. What are we doing wrong? Let's print something. Well, let's put a breakpoint. That'd be faster. Here and here. And let's see if it's being called. It's indeed being called. Oh, my Visual Studio hangs whenever it breaks, so. No. Being called. Yeah, it's actually being called, so. It should be drawn. Let's see what they did. it a little. And it's not working at all. Let translate transformations. I messed up with points or something else. No, I haven't. Let's remove for a moment the scale tool so that we see the cube big enough. In case we see it, of course. No breakpoints. No breakpoints. So let's do the hands, that's surprising. And there's still no cube. That should be pretty straightforward to do. And shouldn't be giving us any problem at all. So that doesn't really make any sense at all. Back to our game. We're only initializing the cube and actually pushing it into the floor with double check it is being called here and here. Our cube code is exactly the same. Maybe our transformation is doing something work. I believe it's not, but no, it's not our transformation. Oh, that is really, really weird. Let's see if rotating we can see something at all. Cube rotate, it's telling guys it's not defined. Oh, that shouldn't be here. It's now defined on the object class here. So yeah, it shouldn't be here. But well, that's not the reason it didn't render, so let's keep seeing. No cube yet. I must be forgetting something. Something real easy that I'm not seeing. I mean, it can't be that hard. It was already working. It should actually be working for real. I mean, let's copy this and go to an older version where it was working. Oh, I think I went. Oh no, that's fine. So here was pure 20 cube modifications. We no longer have cube. Okay, let's deploy it here. Okay, that's fine. So this code here should run as it did before. Well, it won't, there's an error here. So the error is not actually our cube code. Well, that's good to know. That being here, the bad news is we don't actually know where the error is. So that's really, really problematic. Let me check the shaders are here just in case. So what might be going wrong here? There's no override here, but that's not the problem, I should have seen it now. That's weird, because it was working just a moment ago. And it's not now. I mean, we're not doing any transformations at all, right? What might be going wrong here? I don't see it. Let's do a commit and go back to an older version. So git commit session, let's say it's session 3. And we must also commit, I did this in the wrong corner. Well, no problem. Yep. Commit. I actually committed the game first and now the game is in. There are two different gits, so all of them must be committed. I'm pushing it too, just in case. There's no real need for the push, but well, I'll do it. Okay, so now that it's been saved, let's go back to where it used to work. Not that back, I mean, I've just gone way too back. So that's where it used to work, right? Yes, there is. Let's put this back to where it just worked. We've already tried this and this wouldn't work. Maybe some problem related to this being modified. Oh, I don't remember if it was. So this is it. Well, let's go back to this. Not back. Okay, back to this. That's fine. And here, let's also go back to where it used to work. And that's here, I believe. Here. Oh, of course. Okay. How long has this been? Like this, without any number in it. Well, kind of tired. Cube to state is not being implemented because it's now defined again in the old zipper. Well, let's just fall back to the old version. See, here we have a cube. So, it really must be something which changed while updating old code. Let's do a git diff to see changes, analyze what have we done wrong. Of course, I can't move it like this. So, let's search for the error. Everything seems to be pretty much the same. I mean, there's no major change so far. No, I mean, it's everything the same. I'm really curious about this. I mean, it seems like nothing has changed at all, and yet this code runs, and the one with modifications doesn't. So, yeah, that's really curious. Okay, cube. Let's go back to latest version on cube. That's not latest version on cube. And that's latest version on cube. Now let's see if this works or not. Oh, sorry, that must be minus and minus. And the mouse move not being rotate, of course. Rotate is, I don't know how many times I've said it, and still committing the same error. Our cube no longer is here. So it's clear that our error is being made within these lines here. Let's see. We're saving color just fine in the same way, and we're saving saving points just the same way, that's fine. Here points is declared here, new point for non-vertices. Here, same. It's being scaled the same way, which is completely fine. Oh, of course, that's a really novice error, and not having noticed it before kind of changed me. So yeah, now we've just declared our points and colors as a pointer, so its size is 4. Well, not 4, it's the size of a pointer. In case you're coding for 32 bits, it's 4. In case you are for 64, it's 8. Anyway, this size of won't actually return the size. We have multiplied this for every point we have. So yeah, we've changed it everything here, and now here too, this will start working again. That point here. That point here is just the type argument that is requested. So, yeah, I'm pretty sure that was the ROC. Whoa, that's actually not updating every single point, because I bet it's an error on our date CPU. Oh, shit. That's it. Well, that's a funny effort, but that's not our intention, so let's simply set it back at what should be. Whoa, we're missing... We're still missing points here. And that's where... Let's see, what have we done wrong? Size points, number vertices, size colors, number vertices. Of course, then again, I'm wrong. It's not size points, size of point for size of the variable type for the numbers of variables. That's me being really, really tight. And yeah. Now, this should work. So here we go. Our cube is back in. Not scaled, single cube, not even position, that's the floor we were talking about. But we have the cube. Scale is simply commented out. So let's bring it out, let's bring it back in. And there it is. Our cube, scaled, and centered. Okay, that's fine, that's fine. That wasn't a stupid error of me. So let's go back to our 20 cubes we said we wanted to do. That's not actually 20 cubes we have here, it's way less. And I'll have to rewrite the whole code, so I'm not likely rewriting everything. That's why I did that nice comment I did just a moment ago. So, I don't know why I even closed this. So let's see, I get this, and that's game CPP. Yeah, it's game CPP. So yeah, let's keep this always up. And let's go on bringing everything back. So we had an STD vector of cubes, which we are setting back, named floor, where we would simply keep adding cubes. Sorry, where we would simply keep adding cubes like this. We said we'll have 20 cubes for 20 cubes on the x and z axis, so that's a double for. Like this, and simply adding them. Floor pushback cube. Now that's only for the underscore. As it's not a field variable. And once again, delete for auto cube. Or delete cube. It's fine. Back to our rotation method. We said there's no reason to rotate now. And back here, there should be this little loop here. Sorry, this little loop here, which will copy. I'm kind of lazy, you'll see. On all these videos, so yeah. Whoa. Effectively, got some issues with Visual Studio as I reinstalled it, and it's now using tabs for indentation, while I always use four spaces. I don't know if there's any example here, but I always use four spaces, and I'll fix that in a commit tomorrow. Just in case you notice something work on GitHub, that's my fault. So that's it for the thank you call. And we must do exactly the same for the drawing call. But with no threading at all, as all draws must be done on the main thread. So that's what goes for the draw, that in QE method, which we lost in the way. Yeah, oh no, we didn't lost it. I didn't erase anything from thread pool, so no, that's fine. That's completely fine. So again, we will see only one cube, as all of them will be at the very same position. And that makes no sense, but anyways, that should be something. Whoa. Forgot some things here. And I forgot here the third argument. I might duplicate this and delete this. There's no reason for us to have a third argument here that we don't use at all. And go. It won't. I've done some nasty loop here. I found something really wrong somewhere, and I don't know where. Either this or the draw. Something is really bad. Really. Oh, there's some loop here. If not correctly done, that's never ending. I don't think that's the version, but... Oh, sorry. After completing. So, that's the version. Oh. That can be true. That's not an I. It's an A. So yes, I said we can't see more than one cube. They are all in the same position. Let's try to move them a little bit only. That's one thing I don't like now, and that's that this cube, it's no longer 1x1, it's of size 1 divided to sin size. In this case it's 20 if we define it here. We might not tweak like this and perform all the sin transformation size on the GPU alongside all other matrices in the shader, but we'll leave this like this today. It's kind of late already, so let's finish this, and tomorrow we'll see what can we do about this. Translate, okay, and we're going to then replace them at X will be Y. That is y divided 20, as we are using sin dimensions. I mean y x coordinate, that will be that. Y coordinate will be used for height, and right now we'll use 0 as height. And z coordinate must be that. And as we will be using the default OpenGL camera, everything must be on the negative side of the z axis. Well, even if we use a camera defined for us, it's still be negative. It's like convention, it's to make calculus easier. So we'll keep always our set negative and build upon that. And there's no change, and that shouldn't be happening. I mean, there should be some kind of something. Let's go back to our object class. Why isn't it translating or moving our objects? Let's try to do somehow a bigger movement. Here, now we can see it. So it's moving something. Of course, well, that won't actually work, as we must move everything from minus 1 to 1. So that won't actually work indeed. We must do minus 1 as the top left plus y divided to 20. And here will be some things you like, from minus 1 to j, sorry, to j divided by 20. Let's try it. And I've just moved everything with nothing at all. Of course, we won't see nothing. Let's try it. Using the Y just for a moment, just to see what's happening. If we use the def, which is the third component, we can't actually see anything. That's not working, of course. It's clear. So that F0 here might be simply wrong. And that's not moving at all. So that's of course not correct. So here we see it's kind of working as we want it to, but we want to keep this distance as low as possible. Right now this is 1, so that's clearly out, and we have to keep it. Oh, I'm stupid. I mean, of course this won't work. I'm dividing an integer by an integer. You know, in C, if you must divide by floating points, if you want to get a floating point as a result, not by an integer. So, there we go. That's way too ugly, but yeah, that's basically what we wanted to achieve. Not like we wanted, I mean, it's more than what I wanted to do initially. And I don't know if there's 20 cubes here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, there's simply 20. So we actually want to do them a little bit bigger and move them up to this point. But well, we are doing some progress here. That's fine. Well, I think we'll leave it here for today. I mean, it's already late. And tomorrow I must work. So we'd better leave it here. Unless I want to be fired. See, we now move it to where it should be. That's better. Still, we must work on why is it this size. It should be using the world screen, but well, we'll leave that for tomorrow. And well, thank you. If anyone wants to ask something, or feel free, I'm on the chat. You may also ask me things on my Twitter, which goes by the name of LippyTube. So all for you. And of course, you have my YouTube, which is also Libby, where you may find all these videos uploaded, I mean, and you can ask me anything. So, well, thank you. I'll come back tomorrow at more or less the same time, which is the one that's announced here on Twitch. So, yeah, tomorrow more or less at the same time, at 23:30 GM2 Blast 2. Bye.